राधे कृष्ण श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः श्रीमते रामानुजाय नमः। वेलकम टू द भक्ति सीक्रेट एपिसोड नंबर 12। द लेडी ऑफ तिरुकोलूर इज कंटिन्यूइंग हर डिवाइन कंपैरिजंस इन फ्रंट ऑफ स्वामी रामानुजा। इन द लास्ट एपिसोड नंबर 11 वी एक्सप्लेन्ड द कंपैरिजन विच द लेडी ऑफ तिरुकोलूर makes with a great lady saint called Andal. Now, Andal happens to be the daughter of another great Alvar or the Vishnu saints called Periyalvar. Now, in this episode, the lady of Tirukolur is comparing herself with Periyalvar himself. So, her verse, her comparison verse to Swami Ramanuja is, "Did I glorify Lord Narayana as Periyalvar did?" So, what did Periyalvar do in glorifying Lord Narayana is the topic which we are going to see today. So, something about Periyalvar. He was a great Krishna devotee, a Vishnu saint. And the speciality about him was he assumed himself to be Yashoda, that's Krishna's mother, and that's how he expressed his love for Krishna. All his poems, all his hymns have that topic as the central theme, where he assumes the role of Krishna's mother and his love is overflowing as a motherly love for Krishna. So, in an apt sense, he is also referred to as the Yashoda of Kali Yuga. Now, what did Periyalvar do to get that love for Krishna? He started studying the Vedas and the Puranas. But he didn't get that complete satisfaction. He couldn't get what he was searching for. So he tried out a lot of things, and then finally he was reading this Bhagavatam Purana once, which talks about the glories of Lord Krishna. When he came upon an incident mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavata Purana, that there was a flower seller in Vrindavan. His main duty, that's daily task, was to prepare flower garlands and offer it to Lord Krishna. So Lord Krishna was so pleased with him at that time that he granted liberation or moksha to the flower seller. Now this incident attracted Periyalvar. He thought, why should I get into all these complications of the Vedas, the Puranas? Rather, the simplest way to attain liberation is to offer flower garland, just like that particular flower seller offered it in the Dwapara Yuga when Lord Shri Krishna was physically present in his avatar. So he thought he should do the same in Kali Yuga. Now those are creative ideas which people can get. So when he thought of this, he started maintaining a garden, and from there he started plucking his flowers on a day-to-day basis and offering it to the Vishnu temple in his area. Now at that point in time, the region of South India was under the Pandya kingdom. So the Pandya ruler at that point in time was known as Vallabhadeva. So this king Vallabhadeva had a doubt on what is the supreme thing, what is the supreme power, and thinking of which or meditating on which he could attain moksha or liberation. So with that transcendental thought, he approached various scholars. So one of the scholars gave him some kind of a puzzle. So he said, "O king, if you want to have a good night sleep, you should be working hard in the morning time. If you want to live comfortably in the rainy season or in the parts of US in the winter season, you have to work hard in the summer season when the sun is there. If you have to live a comfortable life in your old age, you have to work really hard when you are in your youth. Similarly, if you want to attain liberation or moksha in your next janma, you have to start working from this janma itself." Now the king, he started evaluating these four statements. He was fine with the first three because he was working well in the day, it was his youth time, so he was working hard for the old age, and again season to season he used to manage his duties such that in the rains he has done enough during the preceding summers to take care of that time phase. But he was confused about the last portion, which was doing something in this janma to attain liberation in the next janma. So first of all, we are not at all clear what this concept of various janmas mean. So the king also found himself to be in the same position. So he started thinking more about it, and then he approached one of the learned saints in his court. So he said that this was what the learned scholar told me. So what is this meaning? So how do I do something in this janma to ensure liberation? Now, what the learned saint in his court suggested was, this is not an easy question, obviously, for a single person to answer. So let's have a consensus. Let's have multiple views on this. And you may invite all your learned scholars in the kingdom, and maybe let's keep some kind of a test. So in your palace corridor, hang a bag of gold. So let various debates continue amongst the various scholars, and the one who says the truth, so at that time the bag of gold would automatically lower. So there you would have found your answer, you would have experienced that fact for yourself, and you can give that gold as a gift to the scholar who actually helped you to sense the truth. Now that was the power of truth, which people placed importance on in those days, and even today it's not lost. We still hold the values of Satyameva Jayate, that is, truth alone will trump or prevail to a larger extent. So this was one of the ways to find the truth. It's an interesting way which people employed in the past. So the king, as told or advised by his learned saint in the court, he organized a big gathering. So there were lots of people who came to discuss and debate. Now some had those ulterior motives of just getting the bag of gold, and some were really interested in helping the king. So these debates continued. Now one interesting feature of this debate was, since there were different people, they had multiple views, so they were talking about multiple truths. So each had a view about the powerful deity, and they were talking about the virtues of those particular deities, and that they were the supreme truth. But nothing happened. The bag of gold didn't lower down. So this left the king confused. So he was thinking, there are so many views, there are so many answers, so what is the truth? So his search, his quest was sincere. So he prayed to the Lord that he should soon get to know what is the supreme truth, and that was his request. So Lord Narayana, he appeared in the dream of this Periyalvar. So Periyalvar was out of this scene for a long time, because we were discussing about the king Vallabhadeva, but it has a connection. So Lord Narayana appeared in the dreams of Periyalvar, and he instructed him to go to the court and tell that Lord Narayana is the supreme truth, so that would end the debate. Now Periyalvar, he begged for pardon to Lord Narayana. So in his conversation he states that, "Oh Lord, I'm so happy just plucking these flowers and offering it to you. So why do you want to destroy my peace of mind? In fact, that place where the debates are happening, it would be housed by many scholars who would give all those Vedic interpretations, Puranas. I know nothing except you and my duty of making garlands for you." So the Lord counter questioned him, "So do you really believe, Periyalvar, that I am the supreme truth?" Periyalvar says, "No doubt, Lord." He says, "Just go and say this fact. That's it. You don't need to do anything differently." Thus the Lord spoke to him, and Periyalvar agreed to go to the court. So he goes to the king's court, and on the way there are many people surrounding him, and they ask him where he is going, and when he tells them that he is going to talk about the supreme truth, people start ridiculing him. They start criticizing him. "Oh, you are just a simple garland seller. What do you know about the supreme truth?" Now, these are perceptions which even people carry in the normal today's world as well, right? So that was no different in the past. People will be people. So Periyalvar had that determination not to be cowed down by these criticisms, adverse remarks, and he continued his journey to the kingdom. And when he went to that kingdom, the king Vallabhadeva, he could see some kind of a halo which was accompanying Periyalvar, and he immediately stood to prostrate before him. The other scholars didn't take this nicely. They thought, "Why is the king giving so much respect to an ordinary garland seller? And is this garland maker going to talk about the supreme truth?" So there was a ridicule there also. So it was enough to unnerve any normal human being. So we will talk about this in the modern context towards the end. So when this happened, Periyalvar was unnerved, because it was Lord Narayana who was with him. He had that faith, and he closed his eyes, prayed to Lord Narayana that he should speak within him and reply to all those debates. And wonders happened. That's when he could answer all those interpretations from the Vedas, Shastras, Puranas, and finally he concluded that if one were to surrender at the lotus feet of Lord Narayana, they would attain supreme bliss or moksha at the end. The moment he uttered these words, the bag of gold lowered. Everyone was stunned and shocked that a garland maker had given the supreme truth, to which even the bag of gold lowered. The king was overjoyed. He had got his answers. So a lot of discussions, detailed discussions, had been gone through for the last so many days. And finally, one summary coming out of all those discussions was to surrender at the lotus feet of Lord Narayana. The king was satisfied in his quest, and according to the rules of the competition, he gave away that bag of gold to Periyalvar, and he got his royal elephants because he wanted to do a procession of Periyar Alvar. On those royal elephants, he wanted to tour him across his kingdom for people to see that, look, this was the person who helped me to understand the supreme truth. Now, Periyar Alvar didn't want all these processions or wanted to be in the limelight because he was a selfless person, selfless devotee who was just interested in Lord Krishna, Lord Narayana. But since the king insisted, he went on that royal procession. And just like parents would come to attend their child's convocation or some prize winning ceremony, Lord Vishnu, along with Garuda, he appeared in the skies to witness this marvelous sight. Now, when Periyar Alvar saw Lord Vishnu in the sky, in spite of being elated or pride overcoming him, that look, because of this feat, even Lord Vishnu has come to see me, he didn't have any iota of such pride. In fact, he started praying for the well-being of Lord Vishnu. He says, he sang, "O Lord Vishnu, you are so beautiful. In your form, you chose to appear in this age of Kali. But here, people are so overcome by jealousy, greed. In fact, by seeing you in such a beautiful form, they will cast an evil eye on you. So please be safe. Please be protected." And so he sings these hymns, which in which he requests the Lord to live forever. Now, this was again, the Lord will live forever. He is eternal. But this was the feeling which Periyar Alvar had, as if he would have for his own child. So this is a famous hymn which is sung by all the Vishnu devotees, which was composed by Periyar Alvar. So such was the devotion of Periyar Alvar in Lord Narayana, and such was his determination to overcome all his critics and ensure that he did the duty as instructed by Lord Vishnu. And after completing that duties successfully and in turn getting the best rewards, there was no false pride which overpowered him. In fact, towards the end, he prayed for the well-being of Lord Vishnu. So all these qualities of Periyar Alvar attracted the lady of Tirukkolur. So this was her divine comparison. Did I glorify Lord Narayana as Periyar Alvar did? So what is the key message for us here? So the moment Periyar Alvar left on this mission, he had 10 people to criticize him. Yet he was staunch. He had that belief, that determination in Lord Vishnu. He carried on. When he went into the court, when the king chose to honor him, there were others who were interested in pulling him down. So the usual criticisms, remarks continued, yet he overcame those. So even in our life, we are faced with such situations where we are on a particular mission and there are so many detractors around us, so many critics around us, or it could be some kind of a difficult conversation amongst the family members or close friends. So these type of situations do come to us on a routine basis. So instead of being cowed down by all these threats, these adverse remarks, can we try and focus, just like Periyar Alvar focused on Lord Narayana, nothing else, and he could ensure that his mission was met. Can we also focus on the divine, on the nature, to get that power within us, ensure that we overcome all these adversaries and come out with flying colors. Let's try doing that. Stay tuned for Bhakti Secret number 13. Till then, Radhe Krishna, Sri Gurubhyo Namaha, Shrimate Ramanujaya Namaha.